Good afternoon, I'm Ajay. I'll be talking about unified system for representation of Indian classical music. This I would say resulted out of our a little bit of work we needed to do on symbolic music, and it's still, I would say, it's still work in progress, and all your suggestions would be most welcome. So the initial motivation was that, I mean, as we know, Indian classical music as such is an oral tradition, and there is, even though there is a good amount of notation which has been developed, it is still pretty much in its infancy. It's still evolving, I mean, or it's still changing, and as the day progresses, more and more things have been added and then made a little more systematic. However, it, at the base of it, it still remains an oral tradition, and a notation can is quite, I would say, it's quite limited in its use as such, and this actually led us to, when we wanted to do some symbolic music analysis, it led us to a question wherein what kind of symbolic music notation do we use to actually generate our data so that it can be used in some kind of an empirical music analysis. And the main requirement there was that it needed to be machine readable so that we can process it on a computer and then store it and then archive it. So the main applications, as we saw, were mainly archival and some sort of empirical music research. And if at all that was possible, we could also generate some synthetic melodies, not per se in the flavor of the music which we usually want to hear, but as a verification of if the notated data is fine or not, or those kind of little things. And we also wanted a common platform which could be used for a lot of comparative analysis when we wanted to compare different ragas, or in at the symbolic level, of course, we wanted a common platform. So the challenges which we faced were mainly that any notation as such will never be comprehensive, and it cannot actually, it has to be interpreted in a performance context. And even during when our notation is being read in a teacher-student kind of a context, it has to be learned from a teacher and interpreted accordingly. But and of course, performance nuances and lot of subtleties can never be described in notation and in writing as such. So what we intended to get was a machine-readable notation which has a lossless symbolic mapping at the symbolic level, wherein most of what musicians notate are present in the machine readable notation, and then we can go back and forth. But it need not have been, it's not necessarily needed to be musician friendly, in the sense of a musician can take it and then read through it. It's for use on a computer, and since we have a lossless mapping, it can always be taken back into a representation which can be easily read by a musician. And it should be amenable for a large scale kind of archival and research and analysis, which is the main purpose of this kind of annotation, of course. And it should also be pretty easy to transcribe the existing compositions into this notation, which is pretty important because most of Indian classical music is not digitized as such. Even if it is digitized, it's in the form of images, and then we don't have a symbolic representation as such of Indian music. And when we are looking at a unified representation, we will definitely have to consider what are the things which are common between the two music traditions and what are the things which are different. So the starting point for us was the Humdrum toolkit, which is a pretty standard toolkit which was developed by David Huron. It gives us a syntax for representing symbolic music. So the a brief introduction would be that it's not a specific notation which is imposed, but it's a broad kind of a framework and syntax in which we can represent multiple types of, I would say, symbolic music as such, or it can take multiple voices, it can encode lyrics, it can encode other metadata, or it could encode rhythm. So most of the aspects of music can be represented in, I would say, a 2D kind of a representation, in which it has a large number of what are called spines, and each spine represents one kind of information, and you would have a multiple set of spines. So if you look at it, it would be a 2D kind of a representation. And it's ASCII based, and so which would mean we can do a lot of text processing on that using a lot of text processors. So one representation which was specifically in humdrum syntax is the Kern representation, which is for Western symbolic melodies. And so if you are interested, you can just go and have a look at it at this particular URL here. So when we started out with a composition which could be on a paper format, I mean which could be read out from a book, or I can move here. Thanks. The composition could actually be from a book, or it could be a digitized format, which I would say is a musician readable kind of a format. And then we go into an intermediate representation, which is kind of a trade-off between readability versus an easy transcription. And this intermediate representation actually has components from both, and it enables us for an easy encoding into the humdrum format. So intermediate representation is manually encoded most of the time, since we don't have any automatic tools. So since it's manual, it should be pretty understandable when we actually read it, and it allows for an automatic conversion using a lot of scripts to actually go back into humdrum notation. So there are right now, I think, four actually. For symbolic melodies, we have three. Kern, which represents Western music. Bhat, which is based out of Bhatkhande's notation. It represents Hindustani music that was developed previously a couple of years ago. And now that has been extended to encode Carnatic music compositions as Carnatic. And it provides a common platform for symbolic music analysis. So one of the main challenges was this table was shown to us by Krishna sir today. I think most of us know this, except that there are 16 names of Carnatic swaras, which I've listed here. And so I've listed, I would say, an equivalent set of notes, but the equivalence is not at the level where it's sung or it's played, but only at a representation level. So which would mean a pa and a g and pancham need not be equal, but at a representation level, at the music system, they can be equivalent for the purpose of actually encoding it in a particular machine readable format. So this is the Western scale degree, which is the notation for a note, and then the last one which we see is the common notation which is used for representing all these three swaras and notes into humdrum. And I would say I would not attach too much of importance to this. It's just a way of representation, and then it need not mean anything acoustically. As long as we know what we are representing, it's still a lossless kind of a transcription. So Bhat notation was developed by Parag Chodia in 2007, and it actually is a method for representing bandishes and guts. And he also proposed an intermediate representation based on how we could actually get all the, how we could actually transcribe from Hindustani Sangeet Padati or into an ASCII format, which could be converted to humdrum. It closely follows the Kern format for notes. I'll show you an example and then go through it in a little more detail. And some ornaments such as means, katkas, and kand swaras could be represented. There is a small database of bandishas which are encoded in this format, which could be actually taken from here, which we used in our symbolic music analysis. This is an example here. The panel there is the actual notation from Bhatkhande's book, and it's in Raag Suha. And these are the different metadata which I've encoded, and this is the notation which we see. It starts out with a double slash, and then it has beat markers, and it has a lot of other components, as we saw previously. This is the intermediate notation. So we look at that, and then we manually transcribe it into this. And this is actually transcribed into that using a script. So this is the intermediate representation. It's fairly readable for us. And that is the kind of representation which will be transcribed into later. and that's the book book representation. If we needed to extend this that notation to Carnatic, wherein we had the challenges of a more complex Tala system and we had to encode all the 16 swaras. So though they might actually represent only 12 different swarasthanas, we just wanted to include the entire range so that there's no name, there's no loss of information in as far as the name is concerned. And encoding gamakas is still quite a bit of challenge. I think as long as it is for a machine representation and it's to be interpreted later on whenever we actually want to synthesize it back into melodies. So gamakas are pretty need a lot more of work to actually represent them. So the intermediate representation here was chosen based on the textbooks, I would say, which were developed by Chitraveena Ravikiranji, and I've been using those two books from his permission, obtaining his permission to actually do the transcription here. So as I described, there were mainly the issues which we need to be considered were there were 16 swaras and we use all the variants of not exactly variants but all the sthanas which all the rigamadhani could actually take, and we needed a lossless kind of a mapping. And Tala, we use the same beat markers at the required angas so that we could encode it properly. And the duration of notes, the rhythm is encoded basically in the duration of notes, and they are inverse coded just like Western music and in Bhat. And the nade are implicitly encoded based on the duration. Each beat has an equal duration, which would mean that based on the subbeat division, we can infer the nade directly from the notation. They are not explicitly encoded. And the tempo or the kala is encoded in the metadata, which actually indicates how many letters are there per beat. And for gamakas as such, we don't have an explicit encoding as of now, which is still a matter of actually discussion, and it requires further development. So this is an example here of a varnam in Hamsadhwani, of course. I think there is a small mistake here. It should be Jalayaksha instead of Jalayakshi. So that's the notation which we see in Perfecting Carnatic Music book. And that when we encode it into the intermediate format, it looks like this. I've actually shown split up into two lines to actually accommodate into this space. It's a single linear representation of all the 8 beats of the Aditala. And I have shown only couple of beats here and not the entire duration here. So this is not a particularly intended to be a complete representation from which we can directly get any synthesized melody we want, but it's only for a purpose of archival, which can be further used later on to actually get it into the required kind of format in which can directly be used for synthesis or generation of melodies, or actually even teaching students using the required notation. Right, so the main application was archival and mainly some kind of a comparative analysis which we want to do using symbolic data. It can, once data is in symbolic, it's archived in as symbolic music, there are a lot of search operations which can be done on that, though it may not completely describe the raga bhava, which needs a lot more information, but a basic search based on the scale and based on the rhythm can be directly got from this kind of a representation. And so as long as we need to generate, if at all, new melodies or generate melodies out of compositions which we see there, we need a lot of additional processing, probably which we'll probably learn tomorrow or during the course of this workshop, to actually use our skeletal notation. I think Subramaniam sir has a paper on this. I've read his paper, and then it approaches in a different way. So that kind of a module is required on top of this to actually generate anything which is close to meaningful. I have some MIDI examples to show you how bad it can sound if we directly use this notation and then generate something out of it. So the thing I like the most about this is that it provides us a common platform for analysis of a large number of compositions, both from Carnatic and Hindustani. And if you want to make a comparative analysis at the symbolic level, it is a lot useful. And humdrum can be further extended, and then it can store data using music XML or other present-day formats, and then integrated into a lot of other applications which require this. So let me play this, but then this is not indicative of anything. It's just a couple of, we can just take it as random melody. That's just the mukta of the first bandesh. It's just from the skeletal notation, I've just put it through a MIDI synthesizer and then got it out. I've not done any kind of processing. This is out of the varnam. So, just an example. Yeah. What's this? What is this? Okay, that was.
Even the computer didn't like it.
Why? Yeah, I know. Yeah. Let's see. I would like to acknowledge Hema Madam. She actually, when we had a discussion before, we actually did some of this work. And then I've taken help from a lot of people in Atlanta and Canada. And I want to thank Ravi Kiranji for actually allowing me to use his books. These are some of the references. And it has links to the system which was developed earlier. And yeah, I'll take any questions or any suggestions. Thank you.